first reading for this morning is taking 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 to 11. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be serious and discipline yourselves for the sake of your prayers. Above all, maintain constant love for one another. Love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaining. Like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you has received. Whoever speaks must do so as one speaking the very words of God. Whoever serves must do so with the strength that God supplies, so that God may be glorified in all things through Jesus Christ. To him belong the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the Hallelujah verse.
City flourish is when it has a sufficient sufficient number of really good neighbors. Did you know that? I never really thought of that before. But that's what helps a city flourish, is for a neighborhood to have a place where there are good neighbors. With so many vacant lots and vacant homes, this gentleman wanted to help revitalize those neighborhoods in Detroit. And so he said, the biggest difference maker for a city is actually good neighbors and neighborhoods. When people do something just as simple as caring for their neighbors, a lot of good things begin to happen. When neighbors care, the elderly are watched out for. At-risk young people stop being so at-risk. Crime actually goes down, and people who volunteer actually rises and goes up. Odd things like people begin to take better care of their homes and better care of their yards. Property values are better. Isolated people are less lonely. And most of the problems we have could be eliminated and greatly reduced, he said, if our city just had a sufficient number of really good neighbors. So that's what he was working for. Now it seems to me, when we think of neighbors, who do we think of? Jesus. That's right. It seems to me that this idea, you ought to love your neighbor, is actually kind of significant to Jesus. It's not actually a subtle point that he makes. It's not low down on the priority list. It's actually pretty high on Jesus' list. It seems to me like he gave it quite a lot of airtime. And by the way, Jesus knew a lot about neighbors. This was not an abstract idea for him. He grew up in Nazareth, which was a small town. And he was a carpenter until most likely he was about 30 years old. And so he knew what it was like to have neighbors probably come over to his home and say, you know what, Jesus, can you give me a hand? My table broke and I need some help. Or he probably had neighbors come over and say, well, can I borrow a saw or can I borrow a hammer? You know, Jesus knew all about what it was like to be a neighbor. Jesus, can you do me a favor today? So Jesus brought with him a love and a vision for life in a neighborhood on earth that was full of new possibility, and a new possibility for human relationships. And as a matter of history, because of his idea of neighbor and neighborhood, it changed the world. It really changed the world. And now we're part of it. And now it's time to seek to really do this, to think about neighbors and to think about our neighborhoods. So the most famous story ever about neighbors. Let me read it to you. But wanting to justify himself, the lawyer asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" And Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, and leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. And then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more he spent.' Which of these three," Jesus asked, "do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" And he said, "The one who showed him mercy." And Jesus go and do likewise. Go and do likewise. So the leader asked this Jesus, this lawyer asked Jesus, what is the greatest commandment of all? And of course in Israel, they loved commandments, they loved the law, they revered Torah, which is what the law was called. And Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Now that would be considered just a really good answer for a rabbi. And that was taken what was considered really the most sacred text in all of Israel. It's in the Old Testament book called Deuteronomy, the 6th chapter, the 4th verse. It says, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. Him shall you love with all your heart and all your soul and all your strength. And this was the first prayer that a child in Israel would memorize. And they actually had a name for it. It was called the Shema. It comes from the word hear, which is the beginning of the verse. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. There is one God, this Shema reminds us. One God, this one God made everything, and you ought to love him for everything you're worth. So that's a good answer. That is a very good answer. When Jesus says that, everybody would say, yeah, that's a good rabbi. That's a really good answer. But then Jesus does something very unexpected, something actually quite staggering. He adds an amendment to the Shema, to the Torah, to the command. He says to the guy, and the second commandment is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. Well, what do you mean a second commandment? This guy didn't ask for two commandments. What did he ask for? He asked for the greatest commandment, right? But Jesus says the second is like it. The second is just as important, Jesus says. The second flows out of it. In fact, all the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments, Scripture tells us. Now, we miss how much this would have staggered his hearers. Who has the authority to amend the sacred biblical text? Who can take the text and change it and amend the Shema? Now, the best example that I can think of in our day is if we gather to recite the Pledge of Allegiance. We do that, right, from time to time, which you all know the words, and we can say it together. I pledge, we can say it together, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, for liberty and justice for all. Especially for Grace Lutheran Church members. There we go. I changed it, didn't I? You think if we were over at school and said the pledge, can we just, you can't change a pledge, right? Who gives you permission to change a pledge? We don't have the power to amend it. It's the pledge, for crying out loud. It is the pledge. You can't change it. You can't add to it. Able to do that very thing. And why does he do that? What is Jesus up to in this? Well, there is something terribly important to him, and there is this theme in Judaism. Of course, Jesus is Jewish. That is always present, but it's also always in danger of being lost. And it is the notion that love for God and love for people are always and constantly tied together. Love for God and love for people. You can't separate the two. You cannot ever separate the two. In fact, you cannot love God and not love people. Jesus, in an act of breathtaking authority, nobody else would do this, and of absolute brilliance, Jesus was a brilliant man. He weds these two together in a way that would revolutionize the world. And by the way, he wed them two together in a way that we would never forget. Love is what your life is all about. If you do not love people, then you cannot love God. And he quoted this once. Jesus didn't quote this just once, but he didn't even quote it twice. In fact, he quoted this 8 times in the Gospels. Do you think this was important to Jesus? He quoted it 8 times. In fact, he quoted it so often that it became known as the Great Commandment. It's known to this day, 2,000 years later, as the Great Commandment. You cannot succeed at life and fail at love. And you cannot fail at life if you succeed in love. So love is what your life is all about. Turn to the person next to you and tell them that. Love is what your life is all about. Say it. Love is what your life is all about. Love is what your life is all about. Now as we close here, I just want to look at a few key words here. And 2 of them are in this command, self and neighbor. We're to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. The word neighbor comes from that word nigh, and it simply means to be near. It means to be close. That's where we get the word from. The neighbor is that real, oftentimes imperfect, flesh and blood, actual human being that we live close to. Our life comes in contact with them. And the Bible doesn't say love everybody. Maybe it says that, but it doesn't say, but the Bible is more specific, or at least Jesus is more specific here, right? Only God can love everybody. Here Jesus says, love your neighbor as yourself. And so Jesus gets real concrete. It sounds like Jesus is saying we ought to love ourselves. But Jesus was also famous for saying things like deny yourself, or pick out a cross for yourself, or die to yourself. So which is it? Love yourself or die to yourself? What is Jesus saying here? Yes, he's saying both things. That's exactly right. He's saying both. For we need to remember that love is to will the good for another person. And sometimes that means denying the things that I want or what I need. If you love somebody, you will their good as God intends them to be good. And you actually work toward that goodness being realized in their lives. Let me give you an example. The final moments of Jesus' life were spent on a cross between two thieves. His last neighbors were on a street called Death Row with two other guys on crosses. And one of them wanted nothing to do with Jesus. He mocked him. And the other one, in a moment of great surprise, in his final breath, actually stood up for Jesus and then turned to Jesus and said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus answered him, I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise. Nigh, to be near, to be close to. Jesus said, right now we're neighbors in death, but later on today we're going to be neighbors in heaven. We're going to be neighbors in paradise. And you know what? Jesus is still looking for neighbors. See, that's the movement that changed the world and changes it still. And it can do it right here where we are, in our neighborhoods, because we're part of that. Here is the letter that was sent to us last year on service Sunday, and let me just read this to you. I would personally like to thank you for being an act of service and example of being a Christian community. By the way, this is to the congregation of Grace Lutheran Church. It is so refreshing and humbling when so many people collectively see the needs of others. I am so grateful to each and every one of you who participated in helping with our house. From conversations, siding, carpentry, painting, food, and cleanup, to the young, to the middle, and senior folks that spend time and the effort, I thank you all. Thank you for confirming that prayer is important and answered, and miracles are present, and God is still working among us. Your acts of kindness will never be forgotten. A sincere thank you. Isn't this what it means to be a neighbor? And so we're going to consider that. We're going to look at what it means to be neighbors in our community and in our neighborhoods more next week. But let me end by just saying, or maybe asking a question. Maybe you could ask it to others. Won't you be my neighbor? Amen.